So, Father, we just give you all the praise today. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. You are our God. We are your people. Lord, we're wanting to be partakers of the divine nature. We want to be partakers of everything that you've made available to us. We take authority over the works of the enemy, over his lies. The Lord rebuke you, devil. The Lord rebuke you, lying spirits. The Lord rebuke you, all those that stand against us going forward in Jesus' name. I pray for every wall to be broken down, the eyes of our understanding to be opened. Lord, I pray that we have got hearts to hear what the Spirit of God is saying, ears to hear what you're saying, and hearts to do exactly what you're telling us to do in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Well, a few weeks ago, as you know, I read a scripture, and from that moment on, it's just been burning, bubbling in me. I can't get away from it. But the scripture went, at the end of it, it went that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. The blessing of Abraham. And you know, I just realize that too often we're doing without when God has made a great provision for us. The blessing of God wants to come upon us. You know, the Bible spoke to, when the angel spoke to Mary, said, the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you. And I don't know if we realize or not that it's not just something that's afar, something that's out there that we're trying to grab hold of, but literally the Holy Spirit wants to come upon me, wants to come upon you, wants to overshadow you, wants to come all around you and in you. He wants to be everything to you. He wants to really, if we can grasp some of these things that gets our attention off some of the preconceived ideas or the mindsets that we have about who God is and about the Holy Spirit, and eliminate some of the lies that Satan has implanted into our hearts, to saying things like, you're not good enough, or you're not spiritual enough, or you're not this, or you're not that, you cannot really receive. Friend, I want to tell you this, the day I got born again, God justified me. The day I got born again, I was washed in the blood, and I confessed my sins, and my sins were forgiven, and they were sent away as far as the east is from the west. And today, God loves me with an everlasting love, and God wants to pour out His Spirit upon me. And He says, Neil, everything that I've made available is yours. I don't have to try to earn it, otherwise it becomes works. And then man will try to work and make his way, make it possible to be able to receive. Thank God that it's by faith, amen. So the blessing of God wants to come upon us. We receive the promise through faith. Don't complicate it. Can you turn to somebody and say, don't complicate it? You know, religion, how many people know that religion complicates the things of God? The things that have been so freely given to us, it complicates it. It makes it difficult. And as a matter of fact, it makes it impossible for man to be able to receive from this God, who's so far above. Friend, I want to tell you, He's closer than a brother. He is near me. He said, I'll never ever leave you, Neil. I'll never ever leave you, church. I'll never ever leave you nor forsake you. I'm closer than a brother. And we've got to eliminate all the negatives and all the lies and all the deceit that hold us bound, and don't complicate it. Don't, you know, sometimes we might read a book, 15 steps out. Or 7 steps to receive. I got 1 step for you, receive by faith. One step, receive by faith. Some people I've seen in prayer when we've been praying for people to receive the Holy Spirit, and they're there and they're shaking them and spitting all over them and saying all the things, you know, which we do. And then eventually, because the person doesn't come through, the person will say, it must be because of sin in your life. Well, I want to thank God that I needed the Holy Spirit to get rid of sin out of my life. I needed the Holy Spirit to give me power to overcome sin in my life. Amen. Don't try to wait until you're perfect so the Holy Spirit can come in. If you wait till you're perfect, you don't need the Holy Spirit. But I need the Holy Spirit now to become perfect. Anybody else need the Holy Spirit? Come on, why don't we just lift up our hands and say, Holy Spirit, we need you bad. We need you so bad. Help us, Lord. Help us to overcome and triumph. Don't make it difficult. Don't complicate things. Don't try to, you know, get all this stuff. We make it so hard. Do you ever see your TV set sitting on the mantle or wherever it is there, shaking and trying so hard to receive. Come on, I want to do something so simple so we can catch it. Anybody ever seen some people trying to receive from God? You don't have to do that. You just simply receive, amen. But if there's something wrong with the antenna, if there's something wrong with our belief system, you catch where I'm going here, you get a distorted picture or you get a distorted image, you get a distorted version of what Jesus really said. He just said, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive healing. Receive the power of God. Receive everything that I've given to you. By faith, accepting God, just understanding that God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And we seek Him. You see, the TV, it just sits there and receives. Let me say it again, but if there's something wrong with the antenna, if there's something wrong with our belief system, things will change. I'll just quote a fact here. This is a fact. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, will never lose its power. Can you turn to somebody and say that to them? 1 John 1:7 says this, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Now, the other week I went into deep detail about that word all, the Greek, the Hebrew, the whatever else. And that word all, it's only three letters. You can't do a lot with it. It means all. It just means everything, amen? I am totally cleansed, totally made free, totally washed, amen? Totally. Send us something. I'm totally free, amen? I'm totally free. I'm washed in the blood. I'm cleansed. All things are passed away. God makes all things new. Thank goodness for that, amen. I'm being renewed day by day. Though the outward man is perishing, then there is an inward man that is being renewed day by day. I don't know about you, but I'm glad about that. I'm glad today that I am free. I'm glad today that I've got new life. I thank you, God, that I've got living, just flowing through me, amen. I got a smile on my dial. I've got joy. Sure, there's afflictions, but God delivers us out of them all. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sins. Revelation 12:11 says, and they overcame him, Satan, by the blood of the Lamb. The blood makes available to us all the riches that the covenant represents. All the riches. All. Man, it is impregnated with riches. It is impregnated with deliverance and freedom and liberty. We really need to understand so that we can start to claim the promises. You know, there's some people, they say, that have won the lotteries and things like that. Multi-billions of dollars are claimed. Unclaimed. And we look at those people, we think, why didn't they look at the ticket? Why didn't they, if you bought a ticket, if you went to the trouble of buying a Bible, why don't you read the thing? Yeah. Hey, if you bought a ticket in the lottery, which I don't buy a ticket in the lottery, by the way, but if you did, have a blemish, look at the thing. There's billions of dollars unclaimed, but friend, I want to tell you, in the kingdom of God, there are billions of promises that are unclaimed. And people go without because they don't know what victory Christ won for us. What an amazing victory it is. What an amazing... Come on, I want this thing to come with me. I'll attach myself to it. Amen. All things, everything that the covenant represents. You know what? I believe that we've got to come to value the blood of Jesus Christ as God values it. Let me say that again. We've got to come to value the blood of Jesus Christ as God values it. When He sees the blood, amen? When He sees that precious blood, I want to tell you, it makes His day. He looks at that blood and He looks through that blood and He sees me totally made whole. Perfect. I've got to have confidence in that blood. I've got to understand the blood will never lose its power. The blood represents all the riches of the covenant. We must value the blood as Jesus, as God values it. And only then will our standing and our relationship with God not be doubted or ever questioned again. I see a lot of people today that doubt. They don't really understand where they stand with God. They don't understand, you know, that they've been forgiven properly. They don't understand. And you know, friend, we've got to understand that it's done once and for all. Do you believe that? Once and for all, it's been done. We'll never doubt or question again that I am redeemed. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am redeemed and I know I am. Friend, we should go around singing that song. I am redeemed. I want to tell you, that will send the devil to the doctor. That'll send him to the headache cabinet. That'll send him crazy, amen? Instead of going around saying, I am dead, I am sick. No, I am redeemed. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am redeemed and I know I am. I am redeemed.
I know I'm saying this a lot, but turn to somebody and say, I'm redeemed. We're doing this a lot this morning. But it's good. It's good to confess. It's good to get it into you. I am redeemed. I am redeemed and I know I am. I'm a child of the Most High God. Ephesians 2:11, 12 and 13, it says, therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. But now, everybody say, but. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. You who were afar off. Yes, we were alienated. Yes, we were. Stop acting like an alien. Stop acting like as if we're afar. Don't let that enter into your mind. We once were afar off from God, without hope. No, nothing. But let me just read it to you again. Let's get this into us. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Don't act like an alien. Act like a son. Don't act like a stranger. Act like you belong. Israel was the blood covenant people. The born again church is a blood covenant people. I'm blood covenant with my Christ. I'm in covenant with Him. We, the church, are the blood covenant people. We have a great salvation. It's already been quoted this morning. Hebrews 2, 1, 2 and 3. Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things that we've heard. See, when you're reading the Bible or when we're preaching that, we're not just bashing our gums up here. You're not just reading it because you've got nothing else to do. Read it with an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to you. Let the Spirit of God, let the life of the Spirit that's in the Word of God get in there and do war against the things in our mind that oppose what God's done for us. Let the Spirit, you got to take the more earnest heed to the things that we've heard. We've got to take the more earnest heed, lest we drift away from our inheritance. See, if we don't get a hold of it, what God says, we just start to doubt. When you start to doubt, you start to drift away. You start to drift away from the truth. And all of a sudden, you want something else to take its place. So you get some false doctrine or some false tradition or some lie of the devil. And you start to feed on that, and you just keep drifting away, and you keep drifting away, and you get a little further and further and further. Friend, I want to tell you, the church can drift away from the truth. The church can drift away from what God says and believe a lie. We've got to take the more earnest heed to the things that we've heard, lest we drift away. For if the words spoken through angels prove steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward or penalty, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? We can't escape the enemy unless we know the truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The blood covenant, both old and new, guaranteed Israel, the born-again church, and us, the ones people that have been born again, physical protection, protection from our enemies, protection from pestilence, protection from diseases. When God brought them out of Egypt, He met all of their needs. God met every need that they had. Number one thing they did, they plundered Egypt. They had the silver, they had the gold, they had the cattle, they had the raiment, they had everything that they needed. There was not one sick or feeble among them. See, they received something. They received it. He gave them a cloud of protection from the fierce desert sun. Anybody been out in the sun and all of a sudden the cloud goes over the sun and you think, oh. See, God's protection, He gave them a cloud that followed them. That cloud protected them from the fierce desert sun. I want to tell you, God knows everything about you. He knows what you need. He wants to protect you. He wants to help you. He wants to bless you. I thank God that we've got to understand that the church is a place of blessing, not cursing. I am blessed. Blessed, blessed, blessed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. He gave them this cloud of protection. He gave them, and at night, He gave them a pillar of fire to give them warmth and to give them light. I don't know about you, but the last few nights there, those cold nights, we've been putting on the electric blanket. Oh, I tell you what. Just hop in there. Oh. But see, God knows we don't need an electric blanket with God. These people had a pillar of fire to keep them warm. What an amazing thing. And to give them light. Our God is a good God. But the New Testament says in Ephesians 4:19, "And my God shall supply all your need, or all that you need, according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus." My God will supply all that I need according to His riches, not according to the treasurer or the economy, but according to His riches. You believe that today? What an amazing promise. It's new covenant. The Bible is composed of two covenants, or contracts or agreements. The first was between Abraham and Jehovah. It was sealed by circumcision in Genesis chapter 17. The new covenant is sealed by the new birth. You must be born again. You can't just be a good person and expect to get to heaven. That's an honorable thing, to be a good person, but it won't get you to heaven, unfortunately. Doesn't matter how bad you are, the reception of Jesus Christ is the doorway to heaven. It'll get you into heaven, amen? Give your life to Christ today if you don't know Him. Man could not keep their side of the agreement or the covenant or the law. So God provided them the atonement, or God provided the atonement for the broken agreement or law. Atonement means covering. That's in Exodus 24. Atonement is not a New Testament word. Atonement is not a Greek word. Why? Because the blood of Jesus Christ doesn't cover sin as the atonement, but Jesus' blood cleanses us. Totally cleanses us from all our sins, once and for all. The old covenant, they had to go in and make atonement every year. The new covenant, Jesus died once and for all. How many people are glad about that? Once and for all. You don't have to come out and get saved every week. The old did not take away sin, it merely covered it. The old did not give eternal life, but a promise of it. New covenant language, Romans 8:1, it says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Romans 5:1 says, being therefore justified by faith. Justified by faith. The old covenant only took away. The old covenant, the people there had a promise. A promise of salvation, a promise that they hadn't yet received. This first covenant was sealed by the blood of Abraham, and God sacrificed an animal. If you remember, God spoke and said, take this animal and divide it in half, and then God walked through it and so forth and so from. Abraham was put to sleep, went into a deep sleep. The new covenant is sealed with the blood of Jesus Christ, God's own Son. Because God accepted Jesus' blood when he carried it into the Holy of Holies. At that point of time, Jesus became the mediator of the new covenant. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Him who knew no sin, God made to become sin. Jesus settled the sin problem once and for all. In 2 Corinthians 5:17-18, it says this, it says there, wherefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Old things have become new. I want us just to have a look at this for a moment. Old things have passed away. In other words, old things have died. If we can just grasp some of these things, old things have died and all things have become new. I'm not that old man anymore. I'm not that old thing. Mark 15:17, it says, and Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last, and the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. This was the end of the old and the beginning of the new. It was the beginning of something. You see, religion tries to sew up the veil again. Religion tries to separate man from his God again. Religion tries to say all these things are not for today. The Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not for today. Healing is not for today. All these things are not for today. They've sewn up the veil again. They've sewn it up. And it separates man from God. But you see, when Jesus died and he said it is finished and it was done once and for all, and that curtain was rent, God's power got out into humanity. We didn't have to go in behind the veil with the blood of bulls and goats. Now we have the blood of Jesus Christ, and we can boldly come before the throne of grace, and we can stand in the presence of Almighty God, and we can cry out, Abba Father, and we can cry out, my sins are forgiven. And I don't have to humbly, shamefully, or anything else, but in a appreciation and love and adoration and worship and everything else on the inside of me, come before a holy God and lift up my heart to that God and say, oh, my God, I thank you for this great salvation, because I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am redeemed and I know I am. Hallelujah. I am redeemed. Friend, I can come boldly before the throne of grace. I can enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I can enter his courts with praise. Jesus cried out with a loud voice and he breathed his last. Oh, what an amazing moment this would be. Can you imagine it as Jesus there as he, at this moment, and all those that had died before in faith, believing as they'd sacrificed yearly, as they'd paid atonement for their sins, but those who had died not yet receiving the promise because Jesus hadn't yet been born, Jesus hadn't lived, Abraham and Moses and all those guys that had died before, all up there in the portals of glory wherever they were. We're not going to argue about that. I don't care. All I know is that they're in a good spot. Some people say they're asleep. Some people say they were here somewhere. I don't care where they were. All I know it was good. But wherever they were, they're there watching through the portals of glory, looking out there, watching as Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, as they came and arrested him, as they took him, and they took him before Pilate. And as they took him before Pilate, and Pilate looked at this man and said, I find no fault in this man. As he was being examined, because friend, I want to tell you that if Jesus had any sin in his life, if there was things like that, he would not have been a worthy sacrifice. But I thank my God that Pilate, and through the times of ages, it has been written, this Pilate said, I find no fault in this man. He is worthy. He is worthy, friends. And all the guys up there in glory and all the women that have died believing, and they're watching as their master, as their savior, as their hope. Hope. As their hope of redemption, as their hope of eternal life. If Jesus had have failed, we would have all been failed. But I thank God that my God never failed, amen? I thank God that he never failed. And as Jesus walked in, and like a lamb before his shearers opens not his mouth, so too that this Savior of ours, like a lamb there before his slaughterers, opened not his mouth. And he just walked in there. He could have called down 12 legions of angels. He could have done a lot of things, but he said no. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, knowing that he was going to redeem mankind. What an amazing thing. And all these people are watching, and they're watching, and they're watching, knowing at any time he could have faltered. At any time he could have submitted to the onslaught of the enemy, as people were plucking his beard, as they were spitting upon him, as they were jeering him, as they were pulling him down, as they were rubbishing him, and even his own had turned their back and gone away from him. He could have faltered, friends, and they were watching with anticipation, and there he was as they nailed him to that cross. But friend, I want to tell you, he rose again and he cried out, it is finished. And the veil was rent, and the King of Glory, hallelujah, rose again triumphant over his foes. He went up and slapped the devil up the side of the head and stripped him of all his authority. What an amazing. How shall we, friend, don't drift away. Keep believing God. The enemy will try to drive you away. He'll try to push you back. He'll try to bring discouragement around your life. He'll try to do this. But friend, I want to tell you, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. I want to tell you, friends, you talk about having a party. There would have been a party in glory as Abraham would have went around high-fiving everybody, as they were slapping each other on the back, as they were giving praise and glory and honor. I want to tell you, the band would have struck up 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands upon thousands with loud voices would have been shouting the praises of God. They would have been singing glory, 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 glory to the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. They would have been shouting, friend. I'm going to tell you, you better get yourself ready for a shout in this house. Oh, come on, let's stand to our feet and give him the glory. The Lamb is worthy. The Lamb is worthy. Friend, if you're in this house today and you've never given your life to Christ, if you've never given your life to Christ, if you're out of fellowship with God today, if something's happened and you've drifted away and you want to come back to Jesus, you want to say, Lord, I want to come back. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed to say, I want to come back. I've done it. Anybody else here ever done it? Ever drifted and come back? Come on, give me a wave if you have. Come on, yes, we have. Yes, we have. But friend, if you're in this house today and you want to give your life to Jesus, or you want to come back to God, you want to find your way back, could you just slip out of your seat and come and stand out the front as we sing this song? What are we singing?
The Lamb is worthy.
Come on, you can come. You can come today. If you're not sure, come today. If you're not real sure, come today.